All right, Acts 26, it contains 32 verses. We will have, I'm sure, this typed up. We got 15 pages of notes. We'll begin with just our outline. Father, bless our Sunday school today, and that it would be fruitful in our life now. In Christ's name, I pray, amen. It begins with, "And King Agrippa said unto Paul, thou art permitted to speak for thyself." And so it begins first with the consent. He's given consent to speak. And so that's our first point. Second point, there's 10 of these. In verses 1 through 3, "Then Paul stretched forth the hand and answered for himself, I think myself happy, King Agrippa, because I shall answer for myself this day before thee, touching all things whereof I'm accused of the Jews, especially because I know thee to be expert in all customs, questions which are among the Jews. Wherefore I beseech thee to hear me patiently." And so Paul is, our second one is the consideration. Paul's very considerate. And if we were to go to Proverbs, you win more people over with what? Oh, that's a good one. A soft answer turns away wrath and anger. But no one's angry at this point. I think it's something more vinegar than with honey than with vinegar. I had a little vinegar yesterday. I had this unsightly chicken wire up by the road. And Tammy had gotten us these trumpet vines. This is a long time ago. It could be 15 years ago. We shut the bookstore down. I took the arbor out of there. And I put it over a walkway. All that's removed now. They were, you know, since the bulldozing, all that's gone. And I know. We sold that arbor to a restaurant. They came and picked it up. Somebody who had a restaurant picked it up for their patio. For people eating outside. Anyway, we were trying to get this trumpet vine. Anybody know what trumpet vine is? It's got those orange flowers and grows like a weed. I think at Biltmore, I think it's zipping around on the patio there at Biltmore, the trumpet vine. Is that trumpet vine? Oh, yeah, you're right. I think it is wisteria. Yeah, it could be wisteria. But anyway, I have it out by the street. It's taken me years, just literally years. The first year I had it up, I had them all planted, and we had planters out there, flowers. I had all these trumpet vines planted. I wanted them to go up the post. I wanted to engulf the mailboxes. And eventually that was the game plan. Well, deer think it's candy. They love it. So they would mow it down. Well, the first year, Ben went over there and he's doing me a big favor. What did he do with it, with a weed eater? He cut it all down. I was so upset. Who cut this down? I mean, it's taken years to nurture this and get it
grown. He started to defend himself.
And so he mowed it down. And so they come up again, you know, because they're like weeds. And so it came up again. Finally, I got the one side to go. Finally, I decided last year I got chicken wire to whatever else is coming up so that the deer don't get under there and eat it. So this year I got 2-footers. I put it in the back of the mailboxes to keep it so that the deer can't get it, because on the other side they're starting to come through. Well, the one day I went out there and everything that was coming through was pulled down. I said, wow, that's odd. It was somebody had to reach under and grab it, or it fell down. So I put them all back up and I got this 2-foot chicken wire in the back so that they can only get it from the front and not the back, and everybody can still get to the mailboxes. So anyway, I started to train them to go over the mailboxes and whatnot. And we put it in. We put the mailbox in. The neighbor kid's friend flew in there one day and knocked the whole mailbox over. not the one we have up there now, but it knocked over the fence and all the mailboxes. And we made him pay for it. You want to drive like a nut, you're going to pay for it. So, and Anthony dug the holes. This is when Anthony was still with us. Anyway, we were pulling out, and I told the neighbor, he was out front, I said, well, listen, that chicken wire will only be up there maybe next year, maybe the following year. I said, I'm going to cut it all down. Once it gets so big, the deer won't, they can eat it, but they can't eat it all. You know, they don't eat it till it's nothing. And he said, and he wasn't considerate about it. I mean, he only used vinegar. He says, I don't like it. I don't want it. I don't want it over my box, on my box. And oh, okay. We're just going to keep training it on there. You know, and I said, well, I take scissors to my box and I just cut it away so that the mailman can get in there. We just cut it away. And I mean, what's to stop you from taking scissors and cutting it away so you can get in there and they can put that rag of a paper in there in between it? If we still get a rag of a paper. But man, he was just as, and the wife said, well, he's like that. I don't talk to my neighbor too often. And it was very inconsiderate the way he put it. But I figured, well, we stuck it all up there. I made all the rails. We put the signs up. We put the addresses on. I did all the engraving. We did all the notching. We put it up. But it isn't my, technically, it's really not my property. But anyway, then the post office said, they said, well, that's illegal. You have to be on the, they have to be on the street. So they have to load up four mailboxes. If you were on that busy street and you're at the crest of the hill, where would you rather put the mail? Have the mailman stop at the crest of the hill in traffic or pull off into the, in the driveway? Pull off. Well, then I told him that. I said, well, what would you rather have? Pull off here where it's safe and you can, or cause a possible traffic accident. And then he said, well, we'd rather pull off. So it never went any further than that. They pull off, and it's easy to back out. So then, I think then he said, well, talking to my other neighbor, it's gonna make a blind spot, and you can't be able to see out. And I thought, well, but if it was really overgrown, I pictured it right there, if it was really overgrown, could I still see out? I don't know, but I'm going to make a sign and put it there saying, eat here, so that the deer eat it right next to the street. Well, what's to stop us from trimming that back?
Yeah, but if you plant stuff that the deer like and you don't care about before it gets to you, so your favorite stuff, then you'll be all right. You'll be, definitely, that's what people do. They plant the sacrificial stuff around the garden, and the deer are all happy. They don't come into the garden because I already filled up the stuff that they want to eat and people don't care about.
Well, whatever you said, I was thinking about something else. How does the angel do it in Revelation with the seven churches? When the angel's making his point. And it always starts out good. You know, you guys are really pretty good. But I have somewhat against it, right? You always start out really good. But man, there was no start out of any good. It was just like, oh, and he made sure I knew that this isn't going to be good from the beginning. He said that. All right, verses 4 through 8. He goes through his story to discuss his crime. And in verse 6, judge for the hope of the promise made of God unto our fathers. Okay, so it then goes verses 4 through 8 with the crime. And then verses 9 through 20, this is a good bulk of it, he then discusses his commission. His commission as a lost man, meaning he is persecuting the church, to his commission now as a saved man. So there's two sides to that commission. One when he's lost, and one when he is saved. Verse 21. is the custody for these things. The Jews, oh, caught me. All right, so he was now taken into custody. This shooting down in El Paso, I guess the kid surrendered. You know, they're going to fry him. That kid's going to be fried. Now, why would you, yes?
There was a second one in Dayton last
night. I heard. Yeah, Starlet said something. What was that all about?
Just another guy.
Shooting up. Tell me, is it a Walmart?
It's not going, it's an organized, it's an organized event.
It's organized. Oh, it was an event.
It's the long, this is starting of the long hot summer.
Oh.
All right.
Yeah, when is the long hot, by the way, when is the long hot summer?
1967.
Was it 67?
Yeah,
yes, like the mid-60s.
Democratic.
That's part of the long hot summer? What, Watts, was Watts before that, 65?
It was after that.
It was around there, not JFK. It was Bobby Kennedy, 68. You've got King, and he's a womanizer. You know, they idolize him. You know, lately that came out. That has come out, and they came out against the King, and said that he was a womanizer. You know, these reverends. Pardon?
Don't talk about Elvis that way, King. Elvis.
Well, I just recently heard that, because that is a no-no, that you don't talk bad about that. But that came out a few months ago. Anyway, he's taken into custody. That kid surrendered in, he's wacko, he's crazy. Verses 23 through 24. That Christ should suffer, that he should be the first that should rise from the dead. So he now preaches the cross. The cross. That's our sixth one. And then Festus calls him mad. So then that was the response. The confrontation is verses 25 through 27. He now then confronts King Agrippa. And wait a minute, we got both of them there. He's talking to both of them. Anyway, he confronts them. He now is let's make a decision. He asks like a rhetorical question. Verse 28. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou persuadest me to be a Christian. The convincing. That is, the persuasion is 2 Corinthians 5, I believe it's verse 11, that we are to persuade people. We cannot force people. Only God can force people to do what he would have them to do. And it's the convincing. We're just there to try to convince people, to persuade people. Isn't that what a debate is all about? Is to persuade and to convince people. The convincing. Verse 29. And then Paul said, "I would to God that not only thou, but also all that hear me this day, were both almost and altogether such as I am, accept these bonds." And that is the craving. This is what he really craves. Where are they always trying to make peace in the world? What location?
Israel.
They're always trying to make peace. There will be peace there. When? When Jesus comes back. All the efforts that they're making are worthless. Won't hold up. I know in reading some of these things with by Dr. Ruckman, he said peacetime is just when they clean out their guns and reload. That's it. When they stop the shooting, it's only enough time to to clean out the guns and reload them, just to get going again. The craving, this peace is not going to really come until the Lord comes back, worldwide peace. And by the way, will there be worldwide peace even then, during the millennium? No. And then if they don't come and worship, what happens to those nations? What does God send them? I think drought. He sends them various things. One of them is drought. And then they probably then get with it. Either you get with it or it's just all going to be the worst. The craving of this. And then in verses 30 through 32 is the conclusion. That's our 10th one. So that is going to be the outline. The outline. All right, so let's get started with the consent back at the very beginning. Paul is permitted to speak for thyself. So he's going to tell them, and my goal here is not to tell stories, but there's different ways to preach. One is to tell Bible stories, use the Bible. Another way is to use the headlines of the PD. And so what's the headlines of the PD today? I don't even know. Do they make a Sunday rag today? There's a Sunday rag. What's the headline today? El Paso. Yeah. So Pastor Thompson would say that you would use that to spring off of, or you preach on that. Man, I have steered away from that. But people are interested in that. I think to draw their interest, to get them to listen, you could use that. He uses the headlines. Personal stories, that after a while gets old if you don't have a lot of personal stories and the like. But you can use various methods. The idea here is Paul is really going to use the Bible, the Old Testament. And so we go to Ephesians 6, verse 17. What is Ephesians 6, 17? Of the armor. If he's going to use the Bible. The sword of the
Spirit.
The sword of the Spirit. So he's going to draw the sword of the Spirit. It's sheathed, and he's going to pull this out. And thus saith the Lord. At least, you know, you would like to think that most of all that he's going to preach, and that's what he's going to use, is the sword of the Spirit. All right, so now if the armor of God is in Ephesians, where's the fruit of the Spirit? Galatians. Man, I get that mixed up. Is it Galatians or is it Ephesians? Galatians is the fruit of the Spirit. Ephesians is the armor, the whole armor of God. All right, it opens the way for Paul to fulfill his calling. And Paul is specifically given his calling, Acts 9. Let's go back to Acts 9, 15. Now, listen, we should all know these things. And, you know, what is school? What is the first 6 weeks of first grade? It's a review of what? Kindergarten. The first week of 6 weeks of second grade is a review of first grade, and so on. The first 6 weeks of 12th grade is a review of 11th grade. In other words, you move on, you have a little bit of a review, and then you move on. So review, review, review. There's nothing wrong with review. All right, so it opens the way for Paul to fulfill his calling. Acts 9, verse 15. But the Lord said unto him, Go thy way, for he is a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. So it fulfills that thing to bear his name before kings, whether they're going to listen or whether they're not going to listen. All right, he is a chosen vessel. Give me a vessel that we're likened to in the Old Testament.
Clay jars.
Pardon?
Earthen jars.
I can't understand what you're saying.
Clay jars.
Oh, the clay jars.
No.
Why did Jeremiah put it in? Is it Jeremiah? They put it in a clay jar. The title.
An earthen vessel.
Earthen vessel, but why in that? Now if we go to Romans, or... No, 2 Corinthians 4, verse 8, we are earthen vessel. But give me an Old Testament example of a vessel. We just had it last week. It would have been Gideon, right? The 300 vessels. We break the vessel because we are to be broken for the Lord so that the light can shine. And all those are all kind of types. And then, but why did he put it in a clay jar? Why is the paperwork put in a clay jar and buried? Oh, and it's not, it is Jeremiah, isn't it? It's just the uncle. Pardon?
It won't rot.
It won't rot. That's why they find the Dead Sea Scrolls in a cave. It doesn't rot. You don't put it in an iron box or brass box or... Because those rot. Those will deteriorate. So it's in a clay jar. All right. So it opens the way for Paul to fulfill his calling. In Proverbs 22, let's go there. He'll stand before kings. He will not stand before... What's the rest of that verse?
Mean men.
Mean men, yes. Proverbs 22. Turn there. 22:29. Seest thou a man diligent in his business? He shall stand before kings. He shall not stand before mean men. Now we have to take the Bible just what it says. People that are diligent in his business. So if a person is diligent in his business, he's going to filter to the top and have these opportunities. And that is the kind of a person that's going to fulfill their role. Is it work to be diligent in your business? It is work. And it's a consistent, it's the story of the tortoise and the hare. Who wins the race? The tortoise wins the race. Slow and steady wins the race. Pacing yourself, plodding along, one step at a time. Consistent. People that are consistently evil, bad, they're just going down the tubes, folks. It's diligent in business. In your business, you will stand before kings. You will not stand before mean men. If you're the opposite, you'll stand before mean men. And we could say, well, that's like standing before the judge when he pronounces sentence on you for all the evil that is done. All right, so the consent here, he is permitted to speak for himself. Ephesians, in the armor of God, if we go to Ephesians, one thing that he prayed for, it's at the end of the armor, he prays for utterance or opportunity in which to preach. He prays for opportunities and he prays for boldness. Now, man, when I meet Jewish people, and I do, and in business you meet Jewish people. I don't know if I've ever met one that isn't bold. They're as bold as brass. But he prays for boldness. He prays for them. Verses 19 and 20, and for me that utterance may be given unto me. When the door opens, go through. Utterance, all right, may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Not just boldly, but as he ought to speak. When we witness, what spirit are we supposed to use? 1 Peter 3:15. In meekness, I think it is spirit too. In meekness and in fear. So the way we present it is really important. The way we present it. If you're rude or nasty, there is a time to to be rude and nasty, but there's more times to be not rude, with meekness and with fear. All right, so he prays for these opportunities. All right, the will of God. If you would turn to 1 Peter chapter 4. First Peter 4, verse 2, the will of God. You know, when a person gets saved, they should, things ought to be different. And things ought to change. That he no longer should live the rest of his time in the flesh to the lusts of men, but to the will of God. Is what would God have? And we are to, we're to do that, to give way and for the Spirit to make the will known and the will to be done, the will of God to be done. And so we should no longer be spending the rest of our time in the flesh and the lusts of men. What are some of the lusts of men? What do men live for? Oh yeah, it does. It read the next verse. For the time passed of our life was wrought the will of the Gentiles when we walked in lasciviousness, lust, excess of wine, revelings, banquetings, and abominable adulteries. Now these are wherein they think it strange that you run not with them to the same excess of riot, speaking evil of you. So they speak evil of those that don't do those things. So lasciviousness is sexual sins. People lust for all kinds of things. Excess of wine, I mean they're drunkards. Revelings, whatever they are, parties, banquets, abominable idolatries. Give me some idolatries, which is the sin of witchcraft. Anything that men do.
Sports,
man, all kinds of it. They're going to rot just like any other person, and their body's going to go to the grave and be filled with worms just like everybody else, man. And people just, they can't get enough of it because there's nothing else to live for in their life. They get a thrill out of it. Is baseball for children or for men? What should it be? It's for children. And those should be the fans. But man, there's a lot of grown-up kids. They're grown-up kids. If you ever see a World Series or replays from the 1940s, how are the men dressed? From the 30s and 40s, when they're at the ball game. They're in a suit jacket and a tie. And a hat. Who ended the hat? So-called. JFK, yeah. Kennedy ended the hat. Yeah. Well, my mom and dad, they would go to the ball game. They met during the war. I mean, I have a picture of my dad at the top of the bleachers at the old stadium, probably the one or two years after it was built, back in 1935. And they would go to the ball game. I remember as a kid, we'd get the straight A tickets. All the kids had them. And we would go to the ball game. And man, we had nothing else to do. I went to the ball game, went golfing, caught butterflies. It was a big waste of time. One big, huge waste of time. And we would do that. We would save the tickets. And it was just dumb. It's just what lost people do. What lost people do. They focus on what God would have you do and not what God would have others do. John 21, go there. Yep. Don't focus in on other people. In John 21, Peter is focused on who? What was he at the very end? Who was he focused in on? He was focused in on John. John 21, the Gospel of John, verses 21 and 22. Peter, seeing him, saith to Jesus, Lord, what shall this man do? Jesus saith unto him, If I will that he tarry till I come, what is that to thee? Follow thou me. You mind your own? That's it, exactly it. That was the nice way. And I don't even know if he was kind of blunt. What's that to you? That was pretty blunt. You know, none of your, it's almost like saying none of your business. And then the rumor spread that John was going to be alive when he sees the coming Lord. And was that fulfilled? That was fulfilled when John was exiled on the island of Patmos and he saw the risen Lord coming in his glory there in the book of Revelation. He's telling that God would focus in on what God would have you to do, not on what others are to be doing. In verse 17 of John 21, he saith unto him the third time, Simon, now this is the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest that I love thee. This is the important part. Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep. That is what he is to focus in on. What he is to do, not what John is to do. All right, back here to the book of Acts 26. And now this is the consideration. Paul was considerate. He is speaking to the king. Verse 2, I think myself happy, King Agrippa. So it's kind of like the office of the presidency. How should the president be addressed? Should you address him? Now, if you were his mother, you would say Donald Trump. You might say Donald. But you're not his mother. And even then, you might address him as that title. Jesus kind of said that. He said to his mother, Woman, what have I to do with thee? Because of... He didn't address her that way. Maybe in different places. But in John, when he says that, it's because he's portrayed as God there. But if you address the king, you should address him by title, no matter who it is, no matter who the president is. How should you address a cop?
Blatant.
Officer. And if you say ossifer, they're going to make you walk the line. Get out of the car, please. You know, shine the light. If you officer, if you can't pronounce it right. But you should address him as officer. I don't care if you were going 35 in a place where you could go 45, you feel like you're creeping along and the speed limit's 25. All he can do is make it worse for you. That's all you're doing is tempting him to write you up another citation. Is you should always address him properly. Why? Because of his authority. And so Paul respected authority. Romans 13. You respect the authority. Romans 13. Why don't we just go there? Now, if you're going to talk to, there's Rand Paul, and then what's the other guy? Rand Paul. What's the father's name?
Ron.
Ron Paul and Rand Paul. Now, I don't know which one's which. Ron Paul's the father?
Yeah.
He would run to these verses, well, it doesn't really mean that. And they'll go to some scripture. And man, they do a lot of twists and turns. It says what it says, it means what it says, Another one is where they get the coin out of the fish's mouth, the temple tax. And these guys, these preachers justify they're not paying their income tax. What should you do when it's time for April 15th?
Go fishing.
What should you do? Pay your tax. If you don't, man, we personally know people that have lost everything. They've lost their house, they've lost their wife, they've lost their kids because they rebelled against this and will not pay their income tax. And they try to justify it with the Bible. And there are people, if you turn on the Almost Christian radio station, you're going to get every flavor under the sun of nonsense, of twisting and turning. Verses 1 through 7. Now, Lester Roloff used this to justify his going to jail and not listening to the state authorities. Let every soul be subject unto the higher powers, for there is no power but of God. The powers that are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God, and they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. For rulers are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God. Now there's two different types of ministers in the Bible. There's the minister of God, and then there's the minister of Christ. The minister of God doesn't necessarily have to be a saved man. A minister of God would be Nebuchadnezzar. Those that are doing God's bidding and doing things that God would have them to do, and God uses and directs men this way. And he directs them like a horse with a bridle in his mouth. But if thou do that which is evil, be afraid, for he beareth not the sword in vain, for he is the minister of God, a revenger to execute wrath upon him that doeth evil. What was the evil that Israel did where Nebuchadnezzar came in and took him captive? What was the specific crime? Jeremiah figured it out and he writes about it. That Israel did, and they were taken captive 490 years. By not honoring this, yeah, and by not doing what didn't they do? And folks, we're heaping this up here in this country. They didn't give the land a rest. Every seventh year, you're not to plant. We've met people that actually do that out west. People that actually will leave the land rest won't. But why won't they let the land rest? And they keep planting.
Greed,
money, or lack of trust. I'm not a farmer. I'm not saying I wouldn't do the same thing. You know, if I was in their shoes, would I do the same thing? Who knows? So when is man supposed, when is the average factory worker supposed to give it a rest, man? Give it a rest. When is the assembly line man supposed to give it a rest?
Sunday.
Notice it's seven again. Seven, every seventh day, give it a rest. Right? That's what we're supposed to do. So they didn't, every seventh year they were to give the land a rest, and they heaped it up for 490 years divided in there. That's why they went into captivity for 70 years. Does it seem like a great crime? It doesn't seem like a great crime. Who was killed in the Old Testament? Was David killed for adultery, or was the man killed for picking up sticks on the Sabbath? And that's kind of wild, folks. The stick picker upper on the Sabbath, he got killed where David wasn't killed. And you're supposed to have both people present and all. And we can find all kinds of reasons. But what people think is the ultimate crime, man, in God's eyes, the guy picked up a stick or sticks and he was killed for that. So, but Paul respects authority, such as no matter who is president, we should still address him as president. Paul was courteous, and we'll stop here. 1 Peter 3:8. Let's look up three verses and we'll call it a day. 1 Peter 3:8. 1 Peter 3:8. It says, finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another. Love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous. That's what we're to be. That's what we're to be. Second Timothy 2, in dealing with people, verses 24 through 26. And the servant of the Lord must not strive, but be gentle unto all men, apt to teach, patient, in meekness, instructing those that oppose themselves. If God peradventure will give them repentance to the acknowledging of the truth. So that they may recover themselves out of the snare of the devil, who are taken captive by him at his will. And the other one, we already looked at that or quoted it this morning about in witnessing in 1 Peter 3:15, back there, 1 Peter 3:15, and we'll stop there. But sanctify the Lord God in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason of the hope. Notice they have to ask the reason that hope that is in you. Now I witnessed this weekend, and the guy didn't ask me. I just told him. But it says with meekness and fear. So we need to do it with the right attitude, folks. We need to be considerate. And we'll pick it up here next week. All right? Preaching in 15 minutes.